Hello, this is lecture number 5 of Culture Intermediate course, and I've entitled this one Presuppositions, and that's what we're going to talk about today. Let's first of all ask a very important question. Who are we? Actually, it's a very complicated question. Our culture persuades us to think in a certain way, and all the things that are happening to us and who we are becomes an expression of our culture. And as we've said many times, culture is of course subject to change. However, some of the ways that we think are far older than many of us really know. And again, to reiterate, a culture comes into being by the four pillars that hold it up, which make and shape it: education, politics, business, arts, media, and advertising, and so on. Also holding the culture together is our meta-narrative. Remember that word? The big picture. It holds it together or not, as the case might be. But there is another important thing, which is on a personal level, for it guides us to a conclusion. And that is our presuppositions. Again, many of us don't know that they're there, or that we have them, or that we use them. It's one of those things like a meta-narrative, or maybe like culture itself, that often we don't think about. It actually is incredibly important in our decision making and our actions and the way that we are and who we have become. I want to make a statement here about presuppositions that I want you to think about carefully. Conflict is caused when our presuppositions are at odds with our expectations of how things worked or act. So, our assumptions of what will happen or what it will be like affects us in terms of our presuppositions, and we get very disturbed when our presuppositions don't work correctly. Presuppositions are built into us from birth. They're just there. They're not necessarily analysed. They come from our surrounding culture. They're often generational. They're usually family or tribally orientated. They should be questioned, and they might be wrong. Now let me give you some examples of what I mean by presuppositions. I was talking to somebody one day and I said, and they were from a Western culture, what do you feel or think about if we were talking to somebody who is younger than you are and they don't look at you in the eye? And of course, the general answer from a Western perspective would be, well, either they're not telling the truth, or they're not interested in what I'm saying, or they're just being rude, or they can't be trusted, which is the normal analysis of a Western presupposition about that particular action. However, from some people, particularly from West Africa, if I am younger than you and I look at you in the eye while you're talking to me, I'm being very rude. And so, to be very polite and very respectful to you, I will look away. Now, do you understand what I mean when I say that our presupposition, when our expectations are not applied correctly, it makes us cross? So I've seen people get very cross with that, but actually the poor person whose other culture is telling them not to look at them in the eye because they're younger than the person that they're talking to is actually being very polite and respectful. But because our presupposition tells us something else, we get cross, we draw wrong conclusions, and we've come to a wrong position, and we could actually make us angry. I wonder if you've ever said, I don't understand what they think, or maybe, I don't understand why they act like that. Or perhaps, I don't understand what makes them tick. The thing is, the presuppositions and assumptions colour our expectations, and conflict is caused when the expectations brought about by our presuppositions clash. It is possible for two people to see exactly the same thing from the same angle, and yet when you ask them what they've seen, they will give you widely different answers. And I'm not talking about two people watching a road accident, one from one side of the road and one from the other side of the road. I'm talking about two people seeing exactly the same thing from the same angle at the same time, and yet still giving you different answers. And this is often affected by our presuppositions and our baseline assumptions. All of us, because of our cultures, have built-in baseline assumptions, and we think this is how a thing works. Now, this is a bit of fun, and it probably isn't very serious, but let's see how you get on with it. I want you to look at something. If I was in a classroom situation, then obviously I'd get lots of you to give different answers, but be honest with yourself. Tell yourself what you first saw, and then I'll explain what we're talking about. So just hang along for the next slide. Well, what did you see? Or what are you seeing? Now, some people will say, well, what I am seeing, God is nowhere. Other people will say, no, actually, what I saw is God is now here. Now, that could be from your presuppositions, but I wouldn't guarantee it on this occasion. This is just a bit of fun to emphasize what I'm really saying about presuppositions and baseline assumptions. But it's interesting, isn't it, that in a group of people, you will get almost 50-50 answers as to what they're seeing on this particular slide. Okay, that was a bit of fun. So some will have seen God is now here, some will have seen God is nowhere. Whatever you saw is not particularly serious, but I hope you've got the point. The reality is that culturally our presuppositions tell us certain things, and one of the big things that we've perhaps talked about, or maybe we should talk about, is things like greetings. Different countries have different methods and different ways. In the United Kingdom, we often shake hands. If you're from Eastern Europe, you give each other a bear hug. If you're in France and it's the opposite sex, usually you will kiss the person, and it's three times as you put your arms around them, and one on each cheek. If you're in Spain, you kiss twice, but you have to put your hands behind your back. If you're in Sri Lanka, you don't touch anybody. You put your hands together and say, welcome, hello, nice to see you. But you don't touch anybody by shaking their hands or touching them in any way whatsoever. It's all cultural. I don't think that with these things there is a right or wrong way. It's just how it is. It's their cultural perception of how things are done. The trouble is, if you don't know the correct cultural position, obviously you could end up offending people and upsetting people by doing the wrong thing, and you didn't even know you were doing it wrong. So why are we learning all this? Because if you're to be an effective person in a globalized world, you do need to understand other people's cultures, and you also probably need to understand your own and why you are like you are. We also need to understand where we can get wisdom, and I would tell you that wisdom only comes from God. We need to understand why we think like we think. Where does it come from? And please don't just answer, well, it's from the Bible. Sometimes we need to check that out. For many years, I've heard people say, well, the Bible tells me this. And you look it up and you go through your concordance and you discover there's no such thing in the scripture anywhere. So we need to understand why others think like they do and act like they do, and we need to understand how they're coming from their culture, so that if we want to be good friends and understand them and help them, and we need to understand why they're like they are. I also believe that we need to better understand our culture and other people's cultures so that we can understand the nature of conflict, because different cultures, our assumption, our presupposition that the way we do it is correct will in the end cause conflict. And sometimes, and finally, so where necessary, we can correct our thinking. Some of our thinking is wrong, and we need to analyze it, understand it, find out where it came from, and if it's wrong, correct it. Maybe one of these lectures we'll talk about value systems, because that's a very important part of culture too. I guess we could just carry on without thinking about culture, and I've met lots of people sometimes when I've done this kind of a course, and they've said to me, well, what is culture? That's usually the first question which we tried to answer right at lecture one. But the fact is that many of us don't think about our culture, it's just the way we are. But that, I think, can and does get us into a mess. And also, if we want to help others, say in counselling or being with people, introducing them to the way, then we do need to understand their culture before we do anything else. You go to the New Testament, you'll find that some of the things that we think are just scripture, particularly with Paul on places like Mars Hill, he was actually using the poets of the culture that the people were from. Well, we could not bother and not try and understand. I don't think that's a good way to be. We could be like my alien friend, and this is a bit more fun in this lecture that I'm going to show you in a moment. We could just carry on thinking that everything is okay when actually it's not okay. Just see. And finally, Romans 12 verse 2, and I think this is a very appropriate scripture for culture. Don't be conformed to this world. Don't allow the world to squeeze you into its mold, but be transformed. How? By the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what is the good, well-pleasing and perfect will of God. Thank you for following through on this lecture. All that remains now is to tell you what the test is, and I've listed that on the next slide. For lecture 5 test, I would like a 500 word essay sent back to ICCE, but first of all you have to watch the film Whale Rider. But in your essay, having watched the film, please make comments about presuppositions of the culture that the film is telling you about. And also tell us in the essay, what does the culture that you're looking at tell us about their opinion of women, and how does that compare to the culture that you live in?